Hello, malty, marmiting munchers, and thank you to Peter Scott for the malt mention. Introducing Ralphy Review 640 here in the Manx Bothy with a bottle of Scotch grain whiskey. Not blended whiskey, not single malt whiskey, not blended malt whiskey. This is probably the most obscure category apart from Lohmann stills, which is something different. This is one of the most obscure categories of Scotch whiskey you're likely to come across. And if you do, and if you're thinking about buying a bottle, well, there's things you need to know. And I'm here to share a little bit of experience with you to keep you right. This is Port Dundas, which is a column still grain distillery in the northeast side of Glasgow. It also used to be the site of a very large cooperage with lots of coopers, but they shut it down and paid many of the coopers off, because that's the way things go. But you can still actually get some independent bottlings and even an official bottling of Port Dundas. And it doesn't tend to be on many whiskey drinkers' radar, and that's probably just as well, because it's not a recognisable single malt and it's not a reputable blend. This is essentially whiskey made in Scotland from a mixed mash bill, which is primarily corn, malted barley and wheat. Those are the usual three ingredients. Rarely is rye used, for the very simple reason that if you had rye in the mixed mash bill for a Scotch grain whiskey, it would then be competing with single malt malted barley spirit. And my experience is that single malts and ryes tend to not get on well because they're two strong characters. As they say, opposites attract. And there's nothing opposite about rye and single malt. Anyway, I poured this glass 30 minutes ago for the simple reason this bottle is 37 years old. And that's one of the reasons people might be tempted to buy it if you see it in the shelves of your specialist liquor retailer. You're kind of curious, saying, hang about, if this was a Scotch whiskey, it would be a lot more expensive than this. I think this was about £100 I paid for this just a couple of years ago. You know, that's not a lot of money for such a big age statement, but I really want to put this into context for you, just in case you're thinking of buying a bottle. There's Carsbridge, that's another option. Strathclyde, don't see so much of that. Cameron Brig, North British, these are other grain distillery liquors that are bottled mainly by independent bottlers. But Carsbridge used to be the most interesting of the lot, and I have reviewed Carsbridge, so it's in the archives if you're looking. But I tend to find myself going off this genre of Scotch whiskey, because what's happened is a lot's changed in 5 years. You used to be able to pick up a bottle of old grain whiskey at a relatively cheap price in comparison to single malts, but the way things have evolved now, they're just getting too damn expensive for what they are, because they are not single malt. They have a completely different flavour profile. They have a completely different provenance. For a start, they're not produced in pot stills, although you can produce grain whiskey in a pot still. But by and large, they're produced in column stills because it's cheaper to do so. It isn't malted barley exclusively, as is a malt whiskey. It's malted barley, predominantly corn, wheat, whatever's cheapest. If so say the cynical people. And it's generally considered to be sort of Scotch vodka. It's really just the neutral base for carrying the complex blending of malts in a traditional Scotch blend. But let's get stuck in. I'm kind of looking forward to this and I'm not. It has been bottled, and I'll give you the cask number in case you're looking out for this particular one. It is cask number 128324, okay? And this is 56.1%. Now, that's hell of a strength for 37 years old. But bear in mind the weight, i.e. the viscosity and character of corn-dominated whiskey is different from the more subtle, delicate malted barley whiskey, and therefore the losses are not as great. Also, the whiskey is, grain whiskey is predominantly matured in third, fourth, even fifth or sixth fill ex-bourbon casks, which means that the bourbon cask that was used for this is possibly back in the 1950s when it actually originally get fabricated in the US. But I'm going to add even a bit more water to than this, definitely. There we go. It needs a lot of water, believe me. Someone would describe this as Scotch bourbon. Now, that's a fair assessment in that it's a mixed mash bill, but the similarities kind of end when you start to discuss casks, because of course bourbon by law must be matured in fresh made, charred, tempered American oak casks of a certain size, whereas Scotch grain is going into ex-bourbon casks, ex-sherry casks, ex-anything casks, which have been discontinued predominantly for being used for maturing single malts. Slightly brandyish. That's the first effect you get in the nose. You certainly notice there's a kind of fresh age, as if the cask that this has been in hasn't really been doing very much for a rather long time. Certainly the cask has not dominated this spirit. It still kind of shows itself slightly vanilla, custard, sultana, brown sugar. It's not complex. It's nothing like single malt, malted barley whiskey. There's a slight distant note, actually, of sherry, of fino sherry. Not quite sure what to make of that. Judging by the number of bottles that you're getting from this bottling, which is 259 at that strength, I'm reckoning this is a bourbon cask. Excuse me to quick check. It's simply saying single cask, oak casks. It's not giving any more information than that. Taste-wise, quite a hot. More water. Seriously, more water. Quite a hot, slightly bitter syrup arrival. A little bit of sultana, some bitter wood, more bitter, unpleasant bitter. It really takes time, by the way, for this to settle down and actually become interesting. First contact is not going to give you a particularly positive experience, to be honest. I was going to say, ask myself a question, do I regret buying this bottle? Yes and no. When I bought it, it wasn't too expensive for the age. It's a sort of bottle that I can use as a demonstrator bottle when I'm explaining to people how age can affect a whiskey or not affect a whiskey, the different directions that time and cask can go. not just in single malt, but in grain whiskey. But I'm enjoying the education of this, but there's 10-year-old single malts, which are, frankly, got a lot more to say for themselves and are far, far better value. But of course, you're not paying for a massive age statement. That brandy note, young brandy, 4-6 years old, quite strident. The bitter is subsiding with the addition of water. The intensity of the strength of flavour has not subsided. It does not taste dilute, and you just saw just how much water I added to that. The finish is short. If this was a 37-year-old single malt that had been in a good cask, the finish would be twice the length, the development and finish. It would be far, far more substantial. This is behaving more like a 14 or 15-year-old whiskey. All signs, by the way, all giveaway signs, malt mates, that the cask used for maturing this whiskey has been pretty exhausted to start with and has really taken 37 years to create 14 years worth of maturation. Right. Proving the point now. Older is not necessarily better. But I was curious, malt mates, and I thought, well, I'll just give it about 37 years old. It's a good price. I mean, prices are jumping now, and frankly, they're not worth it. They're, in my opinion, they are not. You're getting quite a number of independent bottlers who see the trends in single malts and other whiskies getting pulled along by single malt's reputation, and they're basically just cashing in. It's real life. So long as we know, you and I, malt mates, that as soon as businesses excessively cash in on their product, we just cash out, move to another product. That's better. We're getting there. It's now doing something a little bit more complexity, the development, herbal notes. Rancio, absolutely. Something you would associate with sherries. But a little bit of coffee, cocoa, nutmeg, yep. Burnt vanilla, yep. The bitterness from the cask is definitely settling down, thank goodness, because it can actually knock it into the malt mark range, which of course is over 80 out of 100. What am I going to give this? I'm going to give it 83 out of 100, which is a Scotch grain mark. More information about grain whiskies. The trend at the moment is that because independent bottlers can buy old casks for far less than it costs for an old cask of single malt whiskey, and generally these are either being kept by official distillers for their own in-house bottlings, or they are being bought back by official distillers from secondary warehouses. The middlemen that you never hear about that actually trade, buy from distilleries to sell on to independent bottlers. Because it is not the case that independent bottlers are backed by direct from the distillery. That can happen. But often a brokerage is used. And certainly with the availability of these old casks, it's very tempting to trade in the age statement, regardless of the calibre of the contents, because inexperienced people in particular are going to be sold the experience by the label. And I mean, this is not a complex, this is a fairly straightforward, relatively informative label. And the two things that feature are the Port Dundas and the 37 years. And often that's enough to sway people that it's unusual, it's worth having. And often these styles of whiskies don't get reviewed, which is another reason I'm reviewing this. I know it's not going to get a whole load of hits in this video. It's a subgroup within the Scotch whisky genre, and as such, not being a 10 or 12 year old standard available single malt, people won't want to watch this video. But you're watching, and what you're doing is learning from my experience that the point in time, the magic moment for buying these types of whiskies was probably about 10 years ago, when they were literally half the price of single malts. You were getting some comprehensive maturation between 20 and 30 years. But it's interesting to note, particularly at whisky tastings, you go back the following year to a whisky tasting, and the previous year's bottling, of course, has gone and has been replaced. And so you've got the same distillery, grain distillery, but it's a year older. And all of a sudden you see that intrinsic complexity that can exist in grain whiskey is suddenly being overtaken, not by the flavour of the maturing casks, but just by time dissolving that complexity as part of the ongoing maturation. So more time in the cask does not mean more gains. And this is quite significantly shown in the likes of these independent grain whisky bottlings. There you go, sharing a, well, it was not a malt moment, it's a grain moment. Just to summarise, grain whisky is a component of blended Scotch. It is basically the vehicle spirit that carries the array and the blends of different single malts to make a palatable, recognisable and pleasant whisky drink. You do have a few official bottlings now of grain whiskies, including Port Dundas, which are kind of brought out really for the collector's market and the enthusiast's market. They're relatively expensive because they're the official bottlings, and frankly, I don't recommend them. I really think you're wasting your money and wasting your time. And I think we're now at the stage where if you go into your bottle store and see 38-year-old Port Dundas, 40-year-old Port Dundas, unless you're an age junkie, frankly, I would steer clear. It's not unpleasant whiskey. It's just that there's far cheaper single malts. Simply far better. It's as simple as that. I'm Ralphie. Hope you've enjoyed this little whiskey moment. To be fair, with time and with enough water, it seriously improves. That's why I've given it a malt mark rather than, I mean, if this was raw and neat, I wouldn't be reviewing it at all. Simple as that. Got a lot of water to this. It doesn't go cloudy, by the way. Do you notice that? No Scotch mist. Very simple reason for that. The vegetal oils in the malted barley that may be used as part of the mash bill, it just does not come through in column stills. Column stills rectify and fractionalise distilling far more clinically than you get in pot stills. It's as simple as that. So you do not get that full range of grain flavours coming through in the boil. Anyway, onwards and upwards. I hope you'll pop back again when in Ralphie Review 641, that's it. I'll be reviewing another single malt, quite probably 21-year-old Jura. Yeah,